So welcome to the computer vision and machine learning talk. My name is Mukta Prasad, and I'm here from Trinity College, Dublin, where I work as an assistant professor. I grew up in India, doing school and university there. I then did a PhD at Oxford, and eventually ended up as a lecturer here. So before we start, let's have a quick review of what is computer vision, right? It's basically a field of computer science that deals with teaching computers to see. So we're going to look at some examples of products that you can use and you might come across that use computer vision. And an example of that is something called 123D Catch. You can take lots of pictures of yourself with a mobile phone or a camera, and what the product will do is it creates a 3D model of you, right? And it's like a 3D selfie, so you can just use it for fun, and you could play around with it, or for more useful applications, such stuff has been used in movies and animation, right? In more serious applications, you would come across technologies like X-ray or CAT scans, which can make 3D models of your body, and you can see any problems inside the body. That can help medical professionals perform surgeries better, diagnose problems better. And you can even have assisted surgery, where a projector projects an image onto the region that is being operated so that the surgeon gets everything right. Okay? There are other useful applications. Like, you might use a computer vision system on a robot that's sent to Mars or another extraterrestrial planet, and you can build panoramic pictures of the terrain. You could use computer vision to understand the scene around you and help the robot navigate its way on the terrain, and help scientists understand what lies out there. Another useful application is something that Mercedes came up with, in which they used computer vision to understand pedestrians in front of the car, and that could help them detect when people suddenly came in front of the car and help stop the car before something terrible happens. These kinds of technologies are rapidly becoming more mainstream, so one day you might find this in your own car, right? Moving on. There are more fun applications. How many of you have come across the Kinect? Right, so maybe you've played this game already, but understanding human body and human motion helps the Kinect create all these cool games where you can play in dance competitions, which is like a dance version of karaoke, I guess, or even exercise and stay fit and stuff like that. If you haven't tried it, please do. And how many of you have come across the Oculus Rift or heard about it? Okay, that's amazing, right. So hopefully one of these days we'll all get to play with it. But here's a great video of how you can use body motion understanding to understand what the hands are doing from a binocular view. And you can imagine that this is what would be played into an Oculus Rift when you put it in your head. And then you can move your hands around and make complex motions, and the system really understands what you're doing. And then you can play cool games where you interact with a virtual world, right? Move stuff around, move yourself around, as you'll see. Now, another cool application is something in the area of augmented reality, very similar to the last example we saw. It's basically a combination of graphics and vision, where you take a rather dull setting, like an office desk, and the program actually understands what this desk is like in 3D. And that helps it insert new, cool virtual characters, like Ewoks, into the scene, right? And they make it look realistic. And then you can design a shooting game or whatever you want in that kind of setting. So these are examples that we come across quite often in movies, but maybe don't think about it so much. In a game like this, it's a bit more obvious. Okay, and the list goes on. You might have tried something like Google Image Search. You might have come across supermarkets where you can use simple devices to tag objects to buy. And the list goes on, right? So we've already kind of seen why computer vision is useful or how it makes a difference to your lives. But why is it difficult? So let's take an example. Here's a project that I did when I was first learning computer vision, right? We took a few pictures of oranges. And you would think of an orange as a very, very simple object that you can see and detect in an image, at least as a human being, right? But how would you write a program to detect this automatically and do it reliably and consistently? So we're going to take this example and discuss that a little bit today. But before that, let's first understand what an image is, okay? An image is basically a table of what we call pixels, okay? And each pixel is composed of a different color, and the final result is an impression that you get of a scene when you look at that. And in order to compose every pixel, light of two, three different components is used to create a certain color, okay? So if there's no light, it's black. And if you throw only red light, you perceive red. If you throw green, you perceive green. If you throw a mixture of two, you perceive yellow. And this is a standard color wheel that maybe you've come across in some other lectures before. In computer vision, or rather in images in general, we usually think of these three components as three numbers, right? So if each of these components is set to zero, you're looking at black. If the red component is set to the max, which is usually a number called 255, you perceive red. If there's only green, you would see 255 in the green and zero in all the other components. And this goes on. And if you see a full value in each component, you would perceive white, right? So going back to the pixel image, something that looks very cyan is likely to have green and blue components, but not so much of the red, which is why its value might be 0, 255, and 255. And a different pixel, which looks very brown, might have a zero blue component, but a very strong red component. Okay? So that's roughly how images work. And what makes this interesting is that as a human being, you're trained to look at an image and perceive three people, even in such a pixelated and coarse image. But what the computer sees is basically a bunch of numbers. Okay? And even though humans are very well trained, we are very well trained to recognize objects, for a computer looking at this image and detecting an object is no different from, for example, if I showed you this image and asked you to find the fish in the image, right? So there is, it's almost like a camouflage problem. It's very difficult for a computer, and it's very difficult to write an automatic program for a computer further, right? Another classic example would be perhaps an image like this, which creates an illusion. You've got lots of patches and a few horses in the image. And if I asked you to accurately detect each of the horses in the image, it would actually be quite difficult, okay? So coming back to our original problem, let's have a little think about how we would go about writing a program to find an orange in an image, okay? Feels very simple. What kind of ideas might we come up with? So maybe you've already thought of this, but let me just propose a few. Maybe we would look for orange color in the image. Maybe we would look for a round shape in the image. And there could be other complicated cues that we might want to use in the program, okay? But we're gonna focus on the first two, which is orangeness and roundness, okay? So how many of you have used Photoshop or any image editor before? Great. So you already know almost what I'm going to talk about now, which is let me try to do the first thing that would come to mind, which is open this image in an editor and try to look at what's happening with the colors, right? So if I took something called an eyedropper tool in one of the programs called GIMP, what I would see is as I move the eyedropper in the orange region, it would select different kinds of orange colors. And what you can see immediately when you do this kind of an experiment is there is no one orange color. There are very many orange colors, and they keep differing in their RGB values. If you want, you can record them by looking at the RGB values on the right menu. And then you might want to use something like this to detect the orange in the image, right? What editors like GIMP will also allow you to do is use some of their more comprehensive color selection tools to locate regions and then try and detect them as accurately as possible. Okay, so as you use your mouse to select more and more regions in the image, the detection becomes more and more accurate, right? So you basically sit and experiment with this until you get some kind of a result that looks realistic. So let's have a little think about what is it that we've just done. We used a program, and we kept tuning this program until the result that we saw in the menu in the red box looks like the mental image of what we think the perfect detection would be, okay? So detection is basically an image which is the same size as the original image and is white where there is an orange and black where there is no orange, okay? That's what I call a detection here. And you keep tuning this until you're happy with the result and then you're all done, right? Now, computer vision is all about the direction that we want to move in computer vision is all about, rather than tuning the program, can the program tune itself? Can the program teach itself to do this? So one way of doing that would be to learn from examples. Let's say I gave you many examples of oranges and what the perfect detections are like. If I then gave you time to learn a program, or gave your program time to learn, would it be able to then look at a new image and find a good segmentation for it, or a good detection for it, right? That's the problem statement, really. And this is what makes machine learning an integral part of computer vision, okay? So if you look up machine learning on Wikipedia, it gives a great definition of it. It's basically a discipline of computer science that deals with construction and study of algorithms that can learn from data, okay? So most programs, how many of you have written a program before this? Okay, so, I mean, when I was in school and I wrote my first program, I probably wrote a program which said, how do you add two numbers or something like that, or how do you print hello world, right? These are, I mean, programs like that are programs where you've explicitly coded everything. So the program is not doing anything uncertain on its own. But we want the program to actually learn from data rather than just follow instructions that we've given it, right? And eventually, we want it to make predictions and decisions that are useful to us. So that's the direction we want to go in. So let's come back to this orange example. Here's an image that I'm going to try and learn something from in order to do this orange detection that I was talking about. And as I was saying before, the image has three components, a red, green, and a blue one. And I don't know if you agree with me. I used to think that the orange would be most clearly visible in the red slice. But actually, it turns out that the blue slice is the one where you can most clearly see the orange. So why don't we try and see if we can just use the blue slice to learn an orange detector? So I'm going to do a small experiment here where I'm going to pick a bunch of random points from the image. Some of them will lie in the orange region, and some of them will lie outside in the background. And as I keep increasing these point samples, what I notice is that all the orange pixels that lie in the foreground are being plotted to the left side of a scale, which is going from 0 to 255. So what you're looking at on the right is the blue value of every pixel that's being selected on the left, right? And if I continue this experiment, I can see that most of the orange region lies on the lower side of the blue scale, and most of the background region lies on the right side of the blue scale. So a simple decision that I could make is, let me just decide a boundary, which is shown in this red line, right? And every pixel whose blue value lies on the left will be classified as orange, and everything that's to the right will be background, right? And if I used this rule on my original images, so on the left, you're looking at the original image that I learned this rule from, and here's what its detection looks like. And if I applied the same rule to new images, what would I get? So here's an image on the right, which is very similar to the original image that we trained from, okay? And you can see that this rule seems to work fine. But what about a new image which has quite a lot of confusing blue stuff? The result's not great, because actually there's blue stuff here that the program might not have seen when it was learning its rules, right? Or what about this image? That's pretty bad too. So let's see if we can use a little bit more information than we did to begin with. So let's add the green channel of the image to the program. And now I'm looking at a 2D plot instead of a 1D plot. How many of you have seen 2D plots before? Or scatter plots before? Okay, not so many. So let me just explain what's going on here. At the bottom, as we move from the left to the right, we're looking at how the blue component varies. So on the left, the blue is very low, and on the right, the blue is very high, okay? And in the vertical direction, the green is what's varying, okay? So at the bottom of the graph, the green is zero, and at the bottom and at the top of the graph, the green is at its maximum, okay? And what I'm doing is I'm taking the same selected foreground points, or rather the orange points that I picked from my example, and plotting them in their positions according to their blue and green values, okay? And what I find is that all the regions that all the pixels that belong to the orange cluster in a little cloud towards the bottom left of this plot. And everything that's background has a slightly different cloud extending across the image, and those are plotted in black crosses, okay? So you can see that there is some difference between these two clouds. And one way of coming up with another rule is to say every time a pixel is such that it lies inside this box according to its green and blue values, it does belong to the orange region, right? And every time a pixel lies outside, it's in the background. Okay, so this is the new decision rule I've come up with. And just as before, I can apply it to both the example that I learned from and to new examples, right? Now, it kind of performs okay on the first example. On new unseen examples, also it performs okay, but there are several parts of the orange that it misses out, and there are several parts in the background that it thinks are orange. So clearly we're not doing as well as we could, perhaps, right? So that's the other two examples that I showed you before. So this is the even more difficult example of the Dorito cover and a real orange in the plant. And what we can do now is we can actually employ all the information that we have from the image, which is the red, green, and the blue components, okay? So now we have a 3D plot. And what this plot shows is basically that in one direction, which is called red, I'm not sure you can see it here, but you can surely see the red increasing in one direction. So every point in this plot is colored according to the RGB values of its location, right? So at the very bottom, everything is black because every component is zero. And at the very top, everything is white because all components are turned up to their maximum. If I move towards the right only, I get very red pixels. If I move towards the left only, I get very green pixels. And similarly, if I move vertically, I get blue pixels. And if I move in a combination of directions or somewhere in the middle, I get a combination of these colors, okay? And what I can do now is I can take every pixel of the original orange image that I had and plot where in this 3D plot it lies according to its color, right? And what you can see is, once again, there is a cloud, which is very which is the orange region, and there is a black cloud, which represents the background region, okay? And if I again came up with some way of creating a box which explains the orange region as well as possible, and then I say that in the future, every pixel that I come across in a new image has to lie in this box for it to actually be the orange, then I can use this rule, once again, as before, to perform detection in both my training example and the new unseen examples, okay? Now, one thing that you can see, and you might be able to see this later on in the slides, is that as we increase the information, things get better. So why do I say things get better here? It doesn't really look great, but compared to before, I'm not getting confused. The program's not getting confused by so much of the background as before. It's able to localize the orange region a little bit better. It is missing out on some stuff, but there's hope, right? And the same for the third test example. Now, this stuff is already a little bit difficult to understand, right? But just to give you a flash of what can be done, we can actually use and learn much more complex color models. Okay, so instead of trying to learn these boxes, we can see that the original color lay in some 3D cloud, and we can try to learn better ways of modeling this cloud mathematically. Okay, so if you just take my word for it, this is what the first row shows: the plot of the colors in 3D, and the bottom is a visual representation of a more complex model that I've learned based on this data, okay? It kind of looks similar, but it's a slightly different representation. And using that allows me to perform detection once again in slightly more improved methods. Now, this particular example on the right is particularly interesting because the reason it gets some of the wall, what seems like the white portion of the wall and confuses it as an orange is because there's a reflection of the orange. And as humans, we're good at blotting it out, but the computer can see it very clearly. So it thinks there's an orange there as well. So there you go. The results are still improving, but not quite there. And one of the things you can do with more complex models is you can use much more data to learn, okay? So previously, I was learning all my rules from one image, but what this complex model allows me to do is use more images to learn a more complex model or a more capable model, okay? And that, in fact, improves my detections much, much more. So this is probably the best result we've seen so far on this Dorito orange, where there's minimal confusion between orange and the background, and the same for the third test case, okay? Now, I'm saying this looks great, but as students, you can all see that it's still not perfect. It doesn't look as perfect as what you expect you could draw if I gave you a great image editor, right? So in addition to using as many images as possible, as much information as possible, we also want to use as many cues as possible. And to start out with, we said an orange can be detected by its color and shape. So one of the things you can do is you can convert the data that you already know into shape representations, like the one shown on the left. So there's actually a circular representation. And then you can also extract what are called edges from images to get the bottom right image. And what that allows you to do is it allows you to run this training shape against the test image and then look for where it matches the image best, okay? And what turns out to be the answer is that. So this is the position where the training image has matched the test image as well as possible. And the reason it's not matching great is because the training image just happened to have a bigger orange, right? And I didn't really, the program didn't really think about scaling or making things bigger or smaller. Okay, so this was the best it could do. Now, the orange is a very simple example, but in practice, the kind of shapes that we want to detect are much more complicated. They could be animals, giraffes, 3D objects. So this kind of a problem actually gets complicated quite quickly, even though we're finding it so difficult to get it working perfectly even on just an orange. Okay? So the lessons we've learned from this simple example are often you've got to use lots of cues and lots of examples to learn a good system that can make good decisions, right? And these complex systems that we write programs for have to be built in such a way that they can learn on their own, right? So they can keep adapting to new data that they see and perform as well as possible, okay? And this is what machine learning allows us to do in computer vision. So this very simple example that I've been talking about is basically what is extended to, let's say, more categories. And then you can write programs which detect different classes like buildings and roads and cars and cows in an image all at the same time, right? So instead of just making a decision about whether something is orange or not, you're actually making a decision about which of 20 objects are in an image, okay? And this is really a state-of-the-art result that ultimately became useful when something like the Kinect was designed, because now we were able to use technology like that to detect body parts and detect body motion and use essentially millions of examples to learn the Kinect, and that's why most of you enjoy using it so much, right? So all that's very good. How do you get involved? Learn maths. It's a great way of becoming comfortable with computer science or programming in the future. Don't be afraid. If you haven't written many programs yet, if you haven't been very comfortable with maths yet, don't be afraid. Just be curious. Constantly think about whether you can combine what you learned in the different sessions today in any project that you do. You can play with photography. There are so many courses online. You might be able to get a simple camera to play with. Play with image editors, Photoshop, GIMP, etc. It gives you a great understanding for how images work. You can even go a step further and play with 3D models and 3D printing if you have access to it. You can play with the code from these slides, and you can get that by emailing me on this at this email ID. These slides and the video will be online, so you'll be able to come back and find this. Okay. So that's it, really. Have fun.